Well, good morning, everyone. Come on, good morning, everyone. It is so wonderful to see all of you. If you can hear my voice, please come join us. If you're with us online, we are so happy that you have joined us. Let's stand together. I'd like to lift up this first song as a prayer. Let's ask the Holy Spirit to come by his presence, to move in our hearts, to move in this place, to move in our neighborhoods and our cities, God, that he would open up the heavens because we want to see him in greater measure today because we ask it in Jesus' name. Come on. Come, oh God. We want to see you more. So we waited for this day. We've gathered in your name, calling out to you.
Yes, Lord.
Your glory like a fire, awakening desire, will burn our hearts with truth.
Say, you're the reason we're here. Come on.
You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Sing. Open up the heavens, we wanna see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart and filling every part of our praise. Oh, come, oh God.
Say your presence in this place, sing it out.
Your presence in this place, your glory on our face, we're looking to the skies. Descending like a cloud, you're standing with us now. Lord, unveil our eyes.
Yes, God, say you're the reason.
You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens, we wanna see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart and filling every part of our praise.
Sing it one more time, come on.
Sing, open up the heavens, we wanna see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart and filling every part of our praise. Show us,
come on,
show us your glory. Show us,
show us your power.
Show us your power, God.
Show us your glory, Lord.
That's our prayer today, God. Sing it again, come on.
Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord. See you open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart and filling every part of our praise.
Oh, open up the heavens,
open up the heavens. We want to see you open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart and filling every part of our praise. Yeah.
Come on, let's give him a shout of praise in this place.
We're here for you, Jesus. Come and move in this place, Lord. So we say, show us,
come on.
Show us your glory. Show us your power. Show us your glory, Lord. Hear our cry, Lord. Sing. Show us your glory. Show us your power.
Show us, yeah. Show us your glory, Lord. Show it.
We want to see your glory, Lord.
Unveil our eyes today, Lord, that we can see you for who you really are, that you are here. You are moving in the midst of us. You are healing hearts, oh God. Even when we don't see you, you are working here, Lord. We ask this, Father, in your name. Let's sing that together.
You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you, I worship.
Let's sing it again.
You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you,
I worship
you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you, I worship
you. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Yeah. We believe it, God.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
You are here, touching every life.
Yes, you are.
I worship you. I worship you. You are here, healing every heart. I worship you. I worship you.
Soon and last around.
You are here, turning lives up.
Worship you. You are here, mending every heart. I worship you.
I worship you. Yeah.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Sing it again, say waymaker, lift it up.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keep, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
So that is who you are.
That is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are. Light in the darkness, my God, that is who.
Come on, every voice. Come on, lift it up, every heart. He's waymaker.
Waymaker, miracle work, promise keep. Light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
And even when I don't see it, come on.
Waymaker,
Let's declare that together. Sing.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. You never stop. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel
I believe
it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. You never stop. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. You never stop. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop. You never stop working. You never stop. You never stop working. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Yeah. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are.
Say, that is who you are.
That is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are. Yeah. That is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are.
Singing.
That is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are.
Say, we trust.
We trust who you are. We trust who you are, Jesus. We trust who you are. We trust who you are.
Say, there's no one like you, God.
There's no one like you, God. There's no one like you, God.
You're faithful.
There's no one like you, God.
You're holy.
There's no one like you, God.
No one like you, Father.
Our hope is in you.
Yes, Lord.
There is no one like you. Teaches this new song. It goes like this.
No praise can define you. No thought can contain you, God.
That's right.
No other one is righteousness.
Let's try that again. Say, no praise.
No praise can define you.
That's right.
No thought can contain you, God.
No other one.
No other one is holy.
No other one.
No the one is robed in righteousness. God, you are my God. Glorious, glorious. God, you are my God. Victorious,
that's right.
Victorious. No light can outshine you. No power can defeat you, God. You're the God who saves. Sing, all the earth will shout your praise. You will never change. You're the God who saves. Sing, from the dawn of time you reign till the end of days. You're the God who saves. Sing, all the earth will shout your praise. You will never change. You're the God who saves. God, you are my God.
Sing.
Glorious, glorious. You are God. You are my God. Victorious, victorious.
Say from the dawn of time.
From the dawn of time you reign till the end of day. You're the God who saves. Sing, all the earth will shout your praise. You will never change. You're the God who saves. Sing, from the dawn of time you reign till the end of day. You're the God who saves. Sing, all the earth will shout your praise. You will never change. You're the God who saves. God, you are my God.
Lift it up.
Glorious, glorious. Who is like you? God, you are my God. Victorious, victorious.
Let's lift up some praise. Just give him thanks. Come on.
Amen. Oh. It's a great morning when we can start with worship together. It's good to see all of you this week. Couldn't help but drive up this morning and kind of have some reflections about all the excitement we had last week. Good to see you this week. God is good. I'll share a little bit about our neighbors in a little bit. I do want to let you know that on the way out last week, not very many people had an opportunity to stop at the William Jessup table. So if you would still like to pick up some information or fill out a request card for more information, you can stop at the table right at back in the back under the missions wall on your way out. Or talk with me because I would love to give you more information about that. This Tuesday is our second terrific Tuesday night, which is for the whole church. Please, it's not just for families, it's for everybody. We are serving meatballs and mashed potatoes and salad and ice cream and watermelon. So if you just want to come over here for dinner at 6 o'clock and get something there, then please join us. We welcome all of you. But make sure you sign up if you're coming so that we can count how many dinners to prepare and also how many t-shirts we might want if you want to do some tie-dye. So Crosswalk on Mission, yes. I want to thank you personally for all the donations to India. This last week, we were able to send out $1,100 of donations. I thank you for that, and they thank you for that. Also, this last week, we were able to collect in donations up to $1,500 for the fire. And I know that more have come in today, so we are loving on our neighbors. We have phone numbers. We are talking with them. And those who have been displaced, we are blessing them as their neighbors, Crosswalk Church. So thank you for being a part of that. You have a connection card inside your bulletin. Please keep us informed. Let us know what's going on. We pray for you every week and praise God for your praises. Let's enjoy our message this morning as God speaks through Pastor Gilbert.
Thank you, Linda. $5 for a tie-dye t-shirt. Come on, guys. Get here on Tuesday. You know, it's a new fab. It's a new thing. It's a new fashion. If I wasn't living in Clovis, I'd be here. But it's good to be back after 2 weeks gone and here for the first time with my beautiful wife, Bethany. And, you know, some of you were wondering if she was real. No, we got married in April and nobody saw her. Heck, I was wondering if she was real as well, you know. But school year finished, and after teaching in Indiana, she's now here in California and gets to come to Sunnyvale for the first time. So fill out that first-time guest, and you'll get a prize, you know. And unlike last week, I hope we get to end both of our services. And we are going to repeat communion. So I know you were here last Sunday, and you did have communion, but the second service people didn't. And so we decided that it would be good to have communion again. And why would we not bring it back to first service? It's such a sacred and special moment in the life of a church. So quite a Sunday that I missed last Sunday. And the week before, I missed the barbecue on the lawn. So I hear that Gabe did well. And then obviously Jim last week. Grateful for these two men who were willing to come and serve Christ in this way amongst the good people of Crosswalk. And this Sunday and the next two Sundays, I've got three in a row here, guys, we will finish our series in Mark's Gospel, and then we'll do something completely different in July and August for the Sundays that I preach in July and August. So this Sunday, Mark's Gospel chapter 11, and I've called this message The King's Toilet Paper. Stay with me, okay? Let's read Mark's Gospel chapter 11. If you haven't got a Bible, it's okay. Listen to it spoken in godly language, okay? With a godly accent, okay? Chapter 11, verse 27. They arrived again in Jerusalem, and while Jesus was walking in the temple courts, the chief priests, the teachers of the law, and the elders came to him. Oh, there's quite a lot of big people. By what authority are you doing these things, they asked. And who gave you authority to do this? Jesus replied, I will ask you one question. Answer me, and I will tell you by what authority I am doing these things. And here's his question. John's baptism, was it from heaven or from men? Tell me. They discussed it amongst themselves and said, if we say from heaven, he will ask, then why didn't you believe him? But if we say from men, they feared the people, for everyone held that John really was a prophet. So they answered Jesus, we don't know. Jesus said, neither will I tell you by what authority I am doing these things. Let's leave that there. It's a fascinating story that we're going to get to as we come through this preach. Let's start. Pope Pius II was a fascinating pope. We're in the 15th century, and Pope Pius decides to visit Scotland. Bad move on two counts. Firstly, his time there is so tempestuous and difficult that he asks God to help him survive the Scots. And if he survives the Scots, he will walk barefooted through the ice and snow to the nearest shrine of Our Lady. That's a 25-mile walk to a place called Dunbar. He did it. And that left him with pain in his feet and his legs for the rest of his life. That's the first reason. The second reason it was a bad move was he fathered a child. And that's not looked upon kindly by the Catholic Church authorities. But the reason why I mention Pope Pius II is because there's a phrase that we use that originated through him. As you know, popes sit on thrones, the papal throne. They are elected monarchs, both under canon law as the supreme head of the Catholic Churches and under international law. They are also the monarchs of the Vatican City State, which is its own country or state. The actual Cathedra Romana is located in St. Peter's Basilica, although now it's a portable throne so that the Pope can conduct Mass outside in Peter Square. But back to Pope Pius. He enjoyed sitting on his throne. And he must have sat on his throne a lot of the time because history records, wait for it, that he kept his chamber pot under his throne. His chamber pot being his toilet, okay? From hence we get the phrase, the slang phrase, related to going to the toilet as sitting on the throne. I like this guy. Because I do a fair bit of throne sitting myself, okay? And the other day, I was blown away. For years, I've sat on my home throne, and I've always had the cheapest of the cheapest, the roughest of the roughest toilet paper. It was mean stuff. Like, every time I sat on the throne, I had a rather intimate exfoliation, you know? It made a man of me. But I'd return from a cross-country trip with my beautiful bride, and a few days later, I was stunned. Somebody had purchased a different kind of toilet paper. No longer the rough and ouch stuff I'd been used to, but the new super soft kind. Sitting on the throne has never been comfier. But as I was sitting on it last week, a thought crossed my mind. How can we have new toilet paper? Because the king of the throne, aka me, never approved a budget increase for toilet paper. Who approved this? Who authorized this luxurious, indulgent splurge of spending? Who's in charge around here? Am I not the one with authority? Or has my authority gone? And so this morning, the topic of this passage from Mark's gospel is this topic of, would Jesus have authorized better toilet paper? Or, who has authority around here? And that brings us full circle to a central Jesus question, which has been around in Mark's gospel since chapter 1. Chapter 1, verse 28, they were amazed at his teaching because he taught them as one who had authority, not as the teachers of the law. And for the first 8 chapters, people were mesmerized at the authority with which Jesus spoke, for they had listened to rabbi after rabbi after rabbi, but this new rabbi was different. He had authority. Now, in our world, a quick recap, there is what we call positional authority. We've mentioned this before. Someone holds the position like a president of a college or of a country, and you give them respect because they hold that position. Or there are others who have authority simply because they bear force, holding a gun or a weapon. And there are others we think about who have authority, and these are people with charismatic personalities. It's just something inside of them, how they hold and conduct themselves. And when they are in front of you, you intuitively know, this is someone I want to listen to. And I mentioned this when I talked about this back in several weeks back, about hearing Mama Maggie one time speak to a group of pastors. And she's like a Mother Teresa in Egypt, an incredible person. And when she stood on the stage in front of thousands of pastors, you could feel the hush fall over the crowd. And she spoke in just a whisper, but the audience just, boy, did she have authority. Now, that's authority in our culture. That's not how we would view authority in Jesus' culture. None of the above. The word for authority that's used here is referring to something that is unique to a Jewish teacher, a Jewish rabbi. So a rabbi, a Jewish teacher, understood that he gained that something, that capability for teaching the scriptures. He gained it from a rabbi that came before him. And there was a ceremony that every rabbi had to go through, a laying on of hands. And one rabbi would pass on that to the next rabbi. By laying his hands on the rabbi, he was investing in that rabbi authority. And that laying on of hands goes all the way back to the very first rabbi, who was Moses in the Jewish tradition. And who laid their hands, or who anointed Moses? Well, that was God. So God anointed Moses with authority, and then Moses, through the laying on of hands, passed it down to every rabbi. So a question that is thrown at Jesus frequently is, where did you get this authority? Who laid hands on you? In other words, what rabbi is behind you? And you remember that was asked of the Apostle Paul, and he said, oh, it's Gamaliel. And Jesus had no answer, except one, God. So Jesus is saying that he gets his authority the same way as Moses got his. So Jesus is presenting himself as the new, if not the greater, Moses. And the people have never experienced authority like this man. Mark's Gospel, chapter 1, verse 27, they were all so amazed, and they asked each other, what is this? A new teaching and with authority. Now, there is amazement at the audacity of this new rabbi on the block. And he's claiming to be equal to Moses? But there is even more amazement, especially by the religious authorities, as they watched and heard some of the peculiar things that Jesus said. Like, this Jesus, this rabbi, was fond of quoting from the Old Testament, the Hebrew Scriptures, and from the law. You have read that it is written, and he would quote the Torah, the law of Moses. And then Jesus would say these words, but I say unto you, and he rewrites the Torah. He takes the most sacred scriptures that they know, and he gives it his own take. Or he would start off saying some of his sayings with words like, truly, truly, I say unto you. And he's giving what he says double emphasis. In other words, he's saying, I'm not just giving out some nice thoughts. This is the real truth. It sounds better in the Hebrew. Chram, chram, I say to you. He walks up to ordinary people. They're known as the Amharats. Ordinary people, working class people. He walks up to the Amharats and he calls them to follow him. And they drop everything and follow him. A rabbi choosing his own disciples? It was always the other way around. You begged the rabbi to choose you. You never would invite an Amharatz, a commoner, to follow a rabbi. There was something about this northern-based Galilean who people were amazed at. And there was something about this northern Galilean rabbi who the senior religious authorities from Jerusalem and the establishment were getting more anxious and concerned about. And that's chapters 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Chapter 11, Jesus walks into Jerusalem. The first 8 chapters, he's been up north, far away from the capital and its politics and its institutions. It's a bit like, you know, who cares what happens up in Eureka or Ripon or anywhere really in Oregon, you know? But now in chapter 11, he enters Jerusalem. It's like now he comes down to the Bay Area, and now it does matter what goes on. This could impact us. And the word to sum up what is happening in Mark's Gospel chapter 11 is the word showdown. And the image that conjures up in my head immediately is like the gunfight at the OK Corral, you know, Wyatt Earp and Doc Holliday, you know. But maybe that's not the image that's right for chapter 11. Think differently. This wasn't a weak little guy taking on the big guys. There's a better picture to imagine. And I'm very grateful to N.T. Wright, the scholar, who gives this illustration. Let me share it with you. It's a busy Friday afternoon. You're in the middle of a Bay Area rush hour. This is pre-COVID work from home fun, okay? And the traffic can't move. And just ahead, there's some cars who've crashed into each other, and it's causing gridlock. Horns are blaring. Taxi drivers are swearing. Hot and tired commuters are eager to get home for the weekend. Nothing is moving, and nobody is fixing it. All at once, a young man walks into the middle of the road, dressed in casual clothes, and he begins to direct the traffic. And drivers are surprised, but they do what he indicates, and the blockage unblocks, and the traffic flows. And the young man is just about to melt away into the crowd when the police arrive. They've been upstaged. And there's no words of thanks, and there's no words of appreciation, and well done. The only question they have as they bundle this young man into their squad car is, who do you think you are? That's the mood in Mark's Gospel chapter 11. Jesus walks into Jerusalem, and the authorities say, who the heck do you think you are? And it's happening in the temple courts. Don't miss that context. While Jesus, verse 27, was walking in the temple courts, the temple has been going about its business for centuries, run by the chief priests and the officials, the scribes, the teachers of the law, the elders, the leaders of the Jewish ruling council, known as the Sanhedrin. Every Jewish person knew the order. Every Jewish person knew the structure. The rabbis are the custodians of the traditions. The scribes, the Pharisees, they're commissioned by rabbis and by the very first rabbi, Moses. And now in comes Jesus, this northerner. Oh, he went to school probably until he was 13 only. He became an apprentice carpenter. He never came to the temple and the rabbi school. He was literate, even articulate with the scriptures, but he came from an Amharatz family, an ordinary family up there in the sticks. He probably went to synagogue one night a week and engaged in debate with the rabbis, but the biggest issue was he was completely unauthorized. And now this unauthorized maverick rabbi has arrived in the temple. Major turmoil. Go back to Mark's Gospel, chapter 11, verse 12, when he enters the temple and there is the famous overturning of the tables, which is all to do with ensuring that the Gentiles, the non-Jews, are still welcome in this central Jewish place of worship. But it gets even bigger. It gets even bigger. The temple was the core of the Jewish community. Everything flowed out of the temple, politically, socially, religiously, legally. The temple was the core. And in Israel at this time, the Jews all knew that it was the king who had ultimate authority over the temple. This is an immense sore spot for the priests. It was no longer them that held rule in the temple. They'd lost their authority. There's that word again, authority. Herod the Great had decided that he would exercise authority over the Israel. And now the Romans, who replaced Herod the Great, were claiming certain rights over religious appointments, even who would be the chief priest. It was no longer chosen by the Jewish ruling council. It was appointed by the Roman ruler, a pagan. King David had planned the temple. His son Solomon had built it. It had been intimately connected with Israeli royalty ever since. The Hasmonean royal family before Herod had acted as both kings and priests. But at this point, everybody knew the person really in charge of the temple was the king, the emperor, the pagan Gentile king, the local king Herod, who was under the tutelage of big king, the emperor Caesar. And now into this political and religious hotbed, this northern rabbi with no schooling called Jesus walks and acts like the one in charge. And he's not just acting like a rabbi, he's acting like a king. Double, even ultimate authority. He clears, verse 15, he clears the temple of the traders who were selling their goods where the Gentiles were supposed to worship. And he pronounces a curse, verse 20 onwards, on a fig tree, the emblem of Israel's prosperity and peace. And verse 20, he just walks into Jerusalem. And this is after verse 9, Palm Sunday, with people waving palm branches, nationalistic, patriotic fervor. It was as if he was the king, the one in charge. It was as if he was the voice of authority. And the tradition, the power brokers of Israel, are freaking out. This upstart is acting as a rabbi. He's even acting as a king. Who does he think he is? So in the temple courts, the area Jesus cleared off profiteers from, they ask him, "By what authority are you doing these things?" Who gave you authority to do this? In other words, who's your rabbi? Who commissioned you? Who appointed you? And Jesus, Jesus with rabbinical brilliance, answers their sharp, pointed, accusative questions with a question himself. Classic rabbinical rabbi stuff. He gives them a riddle. And the riddle is verse 29. I will ask you one question, answer me it, and I will tell you by what authority. And so the question is, John's baptism, was it from heaven or from men? Tell me. Very, very clever. Like, I love this. Like, my Jesus is the smartest debater. Blow it out the water, cool. We think the best stories in chapter 11 are when he clears the temple or when he pronounces a curse. But today, this morning, realize how cool and smart Jesus really is. My Jesus, your Jesus, is wise and very, very, very clever. You see, if Jesus had rolled into town and presented himself as a prophet, you know, outside the stream of tradition, the prophets weren't in the stream of tradition. No problem. Prophets always challenged the rabbis. But Jesus, with immense wisdom, asks them about a prophet who had been in the land, John the Baptist. And everybody held, verse 32, everybody held that John the Baptist was a prophet. And Jesus asks them, this prophet that has been killed, remember he was killed by Herod, was he a prophet who was from God or from not God? In other words, from heaven, which is a Jewish way of saying from God, because they won't use the word God in case they blaspheme. The religious authorities, they didn't know what to do. I want you to, like, imagine this. The finest brains and the biggest authorities in the land are staring at each other thinking, I don't know what to say. I don't know what to do. I don't know what to say. What do we say here? I don't know what to do. If they acknowledge the authority of John the Baptist, then they have conceded that the things that John did in his life were true, and they had to respect what he did, including John baptizing Jesus and announcing him to be God and or from God and the Messiah. And if they don't acknowledge the authority of John the Baptist, then they risk the people revolting against them. And Jesus, with his words, silenced them. Even better, he gets him to say the words they've never had to say in their life. Verse 33. The collective wisdom of Judaism, the authority of Judaism, the teachers, the scribes, the rabbis, the Pharisees, they have to say to this maverick, unskilled rabbi from the north, we don't know. They did know, but they were simply not willing to acknowledge John's authority. And in turn, Jesus steps high above them and holds explicit authority over the highest institutions within Judaism and the entire status quo of the system, the traditions, the way it's done here. The Jewish way was now threatened and turned upside down, is now warned by this man, Jesus. And this is one of the main points that Mark is writing for. People who follow Jesus, who are equipped with the Spirit, are themselves given authority under his direction to act in his name in the world. Where are the traffic jams in our world waiting for us to step in and take charge because no one's fixing them? Where are the temples that need to be challenged? Where are the traditions, the way it's done, the status quo that needs warned? Where are the people who will step up and risk people saying about them, "Who the heck do you think you are?" In chapter 11, Jesus becomes an intolerable person to the authorities in charge. It's time some of us became intolerable. Intolerable in Google, intolerable in Apple, intolerable in the education system, intolerable in city council matters, intolerable in Rotary Club, intolerable in the golf course, intolerable in the Housing Association Committee. This is the prophetic message of Mark's gospel about Jesus, the Messiah King. Oh, it's fun to turn the tables upside down. It's fun. It's fun to walk into Jerusalem with people waving palm branches in front of you. But it's this that is at the core of what Jesus is about. He's challenging the highest authorities in the land, and he's turning everything upside down, and followers of this Jesus do the same. So that's why we stand against injustice. That's why we challenge systems that favor the rich over the poor. That's why we defend those that are the most vulnerable. We are not keepers of the status quo. We are people who turn things upside down. And this does get Jesus into a great deal of trouble. Few revolutionaries live long. But there's another huge truth that Mark pushes to the surface here as we explore and finish the meaning of the gospel of Jesus Christ. There's something revealed here that hits hard, and we need to take the hit. Are you ready? Jesus Christ is the center of Christianity. Jesus Christ is the center of what it means to be a Christian. Christianity is not a set of grand ideas. Christianity is not just an inspired way of living. It's not a set of great aspirations through which we will change the world. No. At the center of Christianity is a person, and that person is Jesus Christ, and Jesus Christ holds the highest authority. I'm not affiliated with a movement. I'm following a person. I am a disciple of Jesus Christ, and I submit to who that person is and what that person says. I confess him. And in confessing him, I confess that Jesus Christ is someone I obey. His teachings are not ideas just to prompt our thinking. His words are not just nice suggestions. His words and his teachings are non-negotiable because he is the highest authority. Too easily, we define Christianity as a faith thing. Yeah, I believe he's the Son of God. I wouldn't think there's many here this morning who wouldn't believe who Jesus was. But Mark's gospel, The gospel that defines Christianity says that Christianity is not a belief thing. Christianity is an act of obedience. It is people doing what Jesus says because he is the highest authority. And from this point on in the story, the people are divided. Some people will hear him and choose to become a disciple of Jesus. Others will refuse to accept his words and kill him. And every time we refuse his words, we kill him again and again and again and again. It is an issue of obedience. Not just saying, yeah, I believe in him. He holds the highest authority. He commands our obedience. And now we come to the Lord's table. Maybe when you hear a message like this, the high calling, the high cost of discipleship, the words of Jesus and the words that I have to obey and honor and follow, you wonder, I don't know if I can do this. How can I live obeying the teachings of Jesus in the society out there? I will be massacred. I will be stood on. How can I outwork the cost of following this Jesus? Come with me to the communion table this morning because there's good news here. Some see the communion table as simply symbolic, a remembrance. The bread tucked away in the top here of this here, the bread is a symbol of his body that was broken. And the cup symbolizes his shed blood for the new covenant, our sins. And there is in communion symbolism, and there is in communion remembrance. But orthodoxy has for centuries held that this is a sacrament. As a sacrament, something special happens. We call it a means of grace. Now, by that we're not meaning that if you don't take this, there's no salvation. This is not about salvation. But sacrament teaches as a means of grace that Christ's presence is here in a greater way than usual. Because when we refer to it as a sacrament, we mean there is some movement happening. And in a sacrament, the movement is always God to us. So in a sacrament, God descends and he meets us in and through the sacraments. The Protestant church believe in two core sacraments, baptism and communion. In baptism, Christ descends and he meets us in the waters of baptism to empower us and to enable us to live out this confession that we've just made, that he is the Christ, the Son of the living God. In communion he comes. And as we eat the bread and as we drink the cup, as we remember his body broken and his blood shed for the new covenant, Christ comes and he meets us in the eating, where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst. And his presence, when he comes, does something. It strengthens us and it encourages us and it meets us with our faltering, failing faith. And as we eat and drink as a means of grace, he nourishes us and he strengthens us to live out our obedience. So there is symbolism and it is remembrance. But the Christian church has always believed in the majority that something more happens, that as we eat together and drink together, Christ is present to strengthen us and encourage us and equip us. And his grace is here for you and I. So come to the table today and eat and drink and receive his presence to meet you where you're at and to give you the grace and the strength for the journey of obedience. Let me pray. And after I finish praying, unfasten the top and take out the wafer bread and then drink the cup and seek his presence. God, would you deal with us kindly? Because we have heard and we know the words of Jesus, but we don't always do them. We need gentleness and kindness, because to do what you ask us, for us to follow your teachings and to live out your authority, always pushes us against the status quo and turns us into revolutionaries where we could get killed. And we make this prayer as we hold elements in our hands, bread and wine. Would you descend? And would your presence as we eat and drink strengthen and affirm our faith that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God, and in your death and burial and resurrection, you have atoned for our sins and brought us into a living relationship with the Father himself. And we are now the sons and daughters of God. Would you affirm it and strengthen us to live this out? In Christ's name, we give thanks for the bread and for the cup and for the one of whom it speaks. In his name we pray. Amen.
Respond to the Lord. Just celebrate what he has done to set us free, to give us life. If during your time of worship you'd like to bring your offering or your tithe, the basket is in the back. Feel free to do that at any time while we're worshiping, or even after if you need to. And come on, let's sing. How great the chasm then lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven, yes, and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. Thank you, God.
Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Let's all stand together. Just sing it from our hearts.
Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory,
yes,
to wear my sin and bear my shame.
Come on, sing it out. The cross.
The cross has spoken. I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, yours forever, Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Sing it out, hallelujah.
Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Hallelujah, come on.
Sing hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Then came the morning that sealed the promise.
Come on.
Your buried body began to breathe.
That's right.
Out of the silence, the roaring lion declares the grave has no claim on me.
Amen. Come on, sing it out.
Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to break. Salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Oh God, you are. Oh God, you are my living hope.
Come on, lift up a shout of praise to the Lord. Come on. And everybody said,
amen.
Amen, amen. Would you just raise your hands with me just to receive this blessing from the Lord today? This is 1 Thessalonians. It says, may God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. May your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The one who calls you is faithful. And he will do it. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Have a wonderful day, everybody. So great to see you today. God bless if you're with us online. Thank you so much. We'll see you next week.